The Gambler by Fyodor Dostoevsky. Read by Ciaran Saward for Saga Egmont. Chapter 1. At length I returned from 2 weeks' leave of absence to find that my patrons had arrived 3 days ago in Roulettenberg. I received from them a welcome quite different to that which I had expected. The general eyed me coldly, greeted me in rather haughty fashion, and dismissed me to pay my respects to his sister. It was clear that from somewhere money had been acquired. I thought I could even detect a certain shamefacedness in the general's glance. Maria Filipovna, too, seemed distraught, and conversed with me with an air of detachment. Nevertheless, she took the money which I handed to her, counted it, and listened to what I had to tell. To luncheon, there were expected that day a Monsieur Mezentsov, a French lady, and an Englishman. For whenever money was in hand, a banquet in Muscovite style was always given. Paulina Alexandrovna, on seeing me, inquired why I had been so long away. Then, without waiting for an answer, she departed. Evidently this was not mere accident, and I felt that I must throw some light upon matters. It was high time that I did so. I was assigned a small room on the fourth floor of the hotel. You must know that I belonged to the general's suite. So far as I could see, the party had already gained some notoriety in the place, which had come to look upon the general as a Russian nobleman of great wealth. Indeed, even before luncheon he charged me, among other things, to get 2,000-franc notes changed for him at the hotel counter, which put us in a position to be thought millionaires at all events for a week. Later, I was about to take Misha and Nadia for a walk, when a summons reached me from the staircase that I must attend the general. He began by deigning to inquire of me where I was going to take the children, and as he did so, I could see that he failed to look me in the eyes. He wanted to do so, but each time was met by me with such a fixed, disrespectful stare that he desisted in confusion. In pompous language, however, which jumbled one sentence into another and at length grew disconnected, he gave me to understand that I was to lead the children altogether away from the casino and out into the park. Finally, his anger exploded, and he added sharply, "I suppose you would like to take them to the casino to play roulette. Well, excuse my speaking so plainly, but I know how addicted you are to gambling. Though I am not your mentor, nor wish to be, at least I have a right to require that you shall not actually compromise me." "I have no money for gambling," I quietly replied.
"But you will soon be in receipt of some," retorted the general, reddening a little as he dived into his writing desk and applied himself to a memorandum book. From it he saw that he had 120 rubles of mine in his keeping. "Let us calculate," he went on. "We must translate these rubles into thalers. Here, take 100 thalers as a round sum. The rest will be safe in my hands."
In silence I took the money.
"You must not be offended at what I say," he continued. "You are too touchy about these things. What I have said merely as a warning. To do so is no more than my right."
When returning home with the children before luncheon, I met a cavalcade of our party riding to view some ruins. 2 splendid carriages, magnificently horsed, with Mademoiselle Blanche, Maria Filipovna, and Polina Alexandrovna in one of them, and the Frenchman, the Englishman, and the general in attendance on horseback. The passers-by stopped to stare at them, for the effect was splendid. The general could not have improved upon it. I calculated that, with the 4,000 francs which I had brought with me, added to what my patrons seemed already to have acquired, the party must be in possession of at least 7,000 or 8,000 francs, though that would be none too much for Mademoiselle Blanche, who with her mother and the Frenchman was also lodging in our hotel. The latter gentleman was called by the lackeys Monsieur le Comte, and Mademoiselle Blanche's mother was dubbed Madame la Comtesse. Perhaps in very truth they were Comte et Comtesse. I knew that Monsieur le Comte would take no notice of me when we met at dinner, as also that the general would not dream of introducing us, nor of recommending me to the Comte. However, the latter had lived a while in Russia, and knew that the person referred to as an учитель is never looked upon as a bird of fine feather. Of course, Strictly speaking, he knew me, but I was an uninvited guest at the luncheon. The general had forgotten to arrange otherwise, or I should have been dispatched to dine at the table d'hôte. Nevertheless, I presented myself in such guise that the general looked at me with a touch of approval, and though the good Maria Filipovna was for showing me my place, the fact of my having previously met the Englishman, Mr. Astley, saved me, and thenceforward I figured as one of the company. This strange Englishman I had met first in Prussia, where we had happened to sit vis-à-vis in a railway train in which I was travelling to overtake our party, while later I had run across him in France, and again in Switzerland, twice within the space of 2 weeks. To think, therefore, that I should suddenly encounter him again here, in Roulettenberg! Never in my life had I known a more retiring man, for he was shy to the pitch of imbecility, yet well aware of the fact, for he was no fool. At the same time, he was a gentle, amiable sort of an individual, and even on our first encounter in Prussia I had contrived to draw him out, and he had told me that he had just been to the North Cape, and was now anxious to visit the fair at Nizhny Novgorod. How he had come to make the general's acquaintance I do not know, but apparently he was much struck with Polina. Also, he was delighted that I should sit next to him at table. He appeared to look upon me as his bosom friend. During the meal, the Frenchman was in great feather. He was discursive and pompous to everyone. In Moscow, too, I remembered, he had blown a great many bubbles. Interminably he discoursed on finance and Russian politics, and though at times the general made feints to contradict him, he did so humbly, and as though wishing not wholly to lose sight of his own dignity. For myself, I was in a curious frame of mind. Even before luncheon was half finished, I had asked myself the old eternal question. Why do I continue to dance attendance upon the general, instead of having left him and his family long ago? Every now and then I would glance at Polina Alexandrovna, but she paid me no attention, until eventually I became so irritated that I decided to play the boor. First of all, I suddenly, and for no reason whatever, plunged loudly and gratuitously into the general conversation. Above everything, I wanted to pick a quarrel with the Frenchman, and with that end in view, I turned to the general and exclaimed in an overbearing sort of way, indeed I think that I actually interrupted him, that summer it had been almost impossible for a Russian to dine anywhere at table d'hôte. The general bent upon me a glance of astonishment. "If one is a man of self-respect," I went on, "one risks abuse by so doing, and is forced to put up with insults of every kind. Both at Paris and on the Rhine, and even in Switzerland, there are so many Poles with their sympathisers, the French, at these table d'hôte, that one cannot get a word in edgeways if one happens only to be a Russian." This I said in French. The general eyed me doubtfully, for he did not know whether to be angry or merely to feel surprised that I should so far forget myself. "Of course, one always learns something everywhere," said the Frenchman in a careless, contemptuous sort of tone. "In Paris, too, I had a dispute with a Pole," I continued, "and then with a French officer who supported him. After that, a section of the Frenchmen present took my part. They did so as soon as I told them the story of how I once threatened to spit into Monseigneur's coffee."
"To spit into it?"
the general inquired with grave disapproval in his tone and a stare of astonishment, while the Frenchman looked at me unbelievingly. "Just so," I replied. "You must know that on one occasion, when for 2 days I had felt certain that at any moment I might have to depart for Rome on business, I repaired to the embassy of the Holy See in Paris to have my passport visaed. There I encountered a sacristan of about 50, and a man dry and cold of mien. After listening politely but with great reserve to my account of myself, this sacristan asked me to wait a little. I was in a great hurry to depart, but of course I sat down, pulled out a copy of L'Opinion Nationale, and fell to reading an extraordinary piece of invective against Russia, which it happened to contain. As I was thus engaged, I heard someone enter an adjoining room and ask for Monseigneur, after which I saw the sacristan make a low bow to the visitor, and then another bow as the visitor took his leave. I ventured to remind the good man of my own business also, whereupon, with an expression of, if anything, increased dryness, he again asked me to wait. Soon a third visitor arrived, who, like myself, had come on business. He was an Austrian man of some sort, and as soon as ever he had stated his errand, he was conducted upstairs. This made me very angry. I rose, approached the sacristan, and told him that, since Monsignor was receiving callers, his lordship might just as well finish off my affair as well. Upon this, the sacristan shrunk back in astonishment. It simply passed his understanding that any insignificant Russian should dare to compare himself with other visitors of Monsignor's. In a tone of the utmost effrontery, as though he were delighted to have a chance of insulting me, he looked me up and down, and then said, "Do you suppose that Monsignor is going to put aside his coffee for you?" But I only cried the louder. "Let me tell you that I'm going to spit into that coffee. Yes, and if you do not get me my passport visa'd this very minute, I shall take it to Monsignor myself." "What, while he is engaged with a cardinal?" screeched the sacristan, again shrinking back in horror. Then, rushing to the door, he spread out his arms as though he would rather die than let me enter. Thereupon I declared that I was a heretic and a barbarian. "Je suis hérétique et barbare," I said, and that these archbishops and cardinals and monsignors and the rest of them meant nothing at all to me. In a word, I showed him that I was not going to give way. He looked at me with an air of infinite resentment. Then he snatched up my passport and departed with it upstairs. A minute later, the passport had been visa'd. "Here it is now, if you care to see it." And I pulled out the document and exhibited the Roman visa.
"But," the general began,
"what really saved you was the fact that you proclaimed yourself a heretic and a barbarian," remarked the Frenchman with a smile.
"Cela n'était pas si bête."
"But is that how Russian subjects ought to be treated? Why, when they settle here, they dare not utter even a word. They are ready even to deny the fact that they are Russians. At all events, at my hotel in Paris, I received far more attention from the company after I had told them about the fracas with the sacristan. A fat Polish nobleman, who had been the most offensive of all who were present at the table d'hôte, at once went upstairs, while some of the Frenchmen were simply disgusted when I told them that 2 years ago I had encountered a man at whom, in 1812, a French hero fired for the mere fun of discharging his musket. That man was then a boy of 10, and his family are still residing in Moscow.
"Impossible,"
the Frenchman spluttered.
"No French soldier would fire at a child."
"Nevertheless, the incident was, as I say," I replied. "A very respected ex-captain told me the story, and I myself could see the scar left on his cheek." The Frenchman then began chattering volubly, and the general supported him. But I recommended the former to read, for example, extracts from the memoirs of General Perovsky, who in 1812 was a prisoner in the hands of the French. Finally, Maria Filipovna said something to interrupt the conversation. The general was furious with me for having started the altercation with the Frenchman. On the other hand, Mr. Astley seemed to take great pleasure in my brush with Monsieur, and rising from the table, proposed that we should go and have a drink together. The same afternoon, at 4 o'clock, I went to have my customary talk with Polina Alexandrovna, and the talk soon extended to a stroll. We entered the park and approached the casino, where Polina seated herself upon a bench near the fountain and sent Nadia away to a little distance to play with some other children. Misha also I dispatched to play by the fountain, and in this fashion we, that is to say, Polina and myself, contrived to find ourselves alone. Of course, we began by talking on business matters. Polina seemed furious when I handed her only 700 gulden, for she had thought to receive from Paris, as the proceeds of the pledging of her diamonds, at least 2,000 gulden, or even more. "Come what may, I must have money," she said, "and get it somehow I will, otherwise I shall be ruined." I asked her what had happened during my absence. "Nothing, except that 2 pieces of news have reached us from St. Petersburg. In the first place, my grandmother is very ill, and unlikely to last another couple of days. We had this from Timothy Petrovich himself, and he is a reliable person. Every moment we are expecting to receive news of the end." "All of you are on tiptoe of expectation?" I queried. "Of course, all of us, and every minute of the day. For 1.5 years now we've been looking for this."
"Looking for it?"
"Yes, looking for it. I'm not her blood relation, you know. I am merely the general's stepdaughter. Yet I am certain that the old lady has remembered me in her will." "Yes, I believe that you will come in for a good deal," I said with some assurance. "Yes, for she is fond of me. But how come you to think so?" I answered this question with another one. That Marquis of yours, I said, is he also familiar with your family secrets?
And why are you yourself so interested in them? Was her retort, as she eyed me with dry grimness.
Never mind. If I'm not mistaken, the general has succeeded in borrowing money of the Marquis.
It may be so.
Is it likely that the Marquis would have lent the money if he had not known something or other about your grandmother? Did you notice, too, that 3 times during luncheon, when speaking of her, he called her La Baboulenka, dear little grandmother? What loving, friendly behaviour, to be sure.
Yes, that is true. As soon as ever he learnt that I was likely to inherit something from her, he began to pay me his addresses. I thought you ought to know that.
Then he has only just begun his courting. Why, I thought he had been doing so a long while.
You know he has not, retorted Polina angrily.
But where on earth did you pick up this Englishman? She said this after a pause.
I knew you would ask about him. Whereupon I told her of my previous encounters with Astley while travelling.
He is very shy, I said, and susceptible. Also, he is in love with you.
Yes, he is in love with me, she replied.
And he is 10 times richer than the Frenchman. In fact, what does the Frenchman possess?
To me, it seems at least doubtful that he possesses anything at all. Oh no, there is no doubt about it. He does possess some chateau or other. Last night, the general told me that for certain. Now, are you satisfied?
Nevertheless, in your place, I should marry the Englishman.
And why? Asked Polina.
Because, though the Frenchman is the handsomer of the two, he is also the baser, whereas the Englishman is not only a man of honour, but 10 times the wealthier of the pair.
Yes, but then the Frenchman is a marquis, and the cleverer of the two, remarked Polina imperturbably.
Is that so? I repeated.
Yes, absolutely.
Polina was not at all pleased at my questions. I could see that she was doing her best to irritate me with the brusquerie of her answers, but I took no notice of this.
It amuses me to see you grow angry, she continued. However, inasmuch as I allow you to indulge in these questions and conjectures, you ought to pay me something for the privilege.
I consider that I have a perfect right to put these questions to you, was my calm retort, for the reason that I am ready to pay for them. And also care little what becomes of me.
Polina giggled. Last time you told me, when on the Schlangenberg, that at a word from me, you would be ready to jump down 1,000 feet into the abyss. Some day, I may remind you of that saying, in order to see if you will be as good as your word. Yes, you may depend upon it that I shall do so. I hate you because I have allowed you to go to such lengths, and I also hate you, and still more, because you are so necessary to me. For the time being, I want you, so I must keep you.
Then she made a movement to rise. Her tone had sounded very angry. Indeed, of late, her talks with me had invariably ended on a note of temper and irritation. Yes, of real temper.
May I ask you who is this Mademoiselle Blanche?
I inquired, since I did not wish Polina to depart without an explanation.
You know who she is. Just Mademoiselle Blanche. Nothing further has transpired. Probably she will soon be Madame General. That is to say, if the rumours that Grandmama is nearing her end should prove true. Mademoiselle Blanche, with her mother and her cousin, the Marquis, know very well that, as things now stand, we are ruined.
And is the General at last in love?
That has nothing to do with it. Listen to me. Take these 700 florins and go and play roulette with them. Win as much for me as you can. For I'm badly in need of money. So saying, she called Nadia back to her side and entered the casino, where she joined the rest of our party. For myself, I took, in musing astonishment, the first path to the left. Something had seemed to strike my brain when she told me to go and play roulette. Strangely enough, that something had also seemed to make me hesitate and to set me analysing my feelings with regard to her. In fact, during the 2 weeks of my absence, I had felt far more at my ease than I did now. On the day of my return, although while travelling I had moped like an imbecile, rushed about like a man in a fever, and actually beheld her in my dreams. Indeed, on one occasion, this happened in Switzerland, when I was asleep in the train,
I had spoken aloud to her, and set all my fellow travellers laughing. Again, therefore, I put to myself the question, do I, or do I not, love her? And again I could return myself no answer. Or rather, for the 100th time I told myself that I detested her. Yes, I detested her. There were moments, more especially at the close of our talks together, where I would gladly have given half my life to have strangled her. I swear that had there at such moments been a sharp knife ready to my hand, I would have seized that knife with pleasure and plunged it into her breast. Yet I also swear that if, on the Schlangenberg, she had really said to me, "Leap into that abyss," I should have leapt into it, and with equal pleasure. Yes, this I knew well. One way or the other, the thing must soon be ended. She, too, knew it in some curious way. The thought that I was fully conscious of her inaccessibility and of the impossibility of my ever realizing my dreams afforded her, I am certain, the keenest possible pleasure. Otherwise, is it likely that she, the cautious and clever woman that she was, would have indulged in this familiarity and openness with me? Hitherto, I concluded, she had looked upon me in the same light that the old empress did upon her servant, the empress who hesitated not to unrobe herself before her slave, since she did not account a slave a man. Yes, often Polina must have taken me for something less than a man. Still, she had charged me with a commission, to win what I could at roulette. Yet all the time I could not help wondering why it was so necessary for her to win something, and what new schemes could have sprung to birth in her ever-fertile brain. A host of new and unknown factors seemed to have arisen during the last 2 weeks. Well, it behooved me to divine them, and to probe them, and that as soon as possible. Yet, not now. At the present moment, I must repair to the roulette table.
Chapter 2. I confess I did not like it. Although I had made up my mind to play, I felt averse to doing so on behalf of someone else. In fact, it almost upset my balance, and I entered the gaming rooms with an angry feeling at my heart. At first glance, the scene irritated me. Never at any time have I been able to bear the flunkyishness which one meets in the press of the world at large, but more especially in that of Russia, where, almost every evening, journalists write on two subjects in particular, namely, on the splendour and luxury of the casinos to be found in the Rhenish towns, and on the heaps of gold which are daily to be seen lying on their tables. Those journalists are not paid for doing so. They write thus merely out of a spirit of disinterested complacence. There is nothing splendid about the establishments in question. And not only are there no heaps of gold to be seen lying on their tables, but also there is very little money to be seen at all. Of course, during the season, some madman or other may make his appearance, generally an Englishman, or an Asiatic, or a Turk, and, as it happened during the summer of which I write, win or lose a great deal. But as regards the rest of the crowd, it plays only for petty gulden, and seldom does much wealth figure on the board. When, on the present occasion, I entered the gaming rooms, for the first time in my life, it was several moments before I could even make up my mind to play. For one thing, the crowd oppressed me. Had I been playing for myself, I think I should have left at once, and never have embarked upon gambling at all, for I could feel my heart beginning to beat, and my heart was anything but cold-blooded. Also, I knew I had long ago made up my mind that never should I depart from Roulettenberg until some final change had taken place in my fortunes. Thus, it must and would be. However ridiculous it may seem to you that I was expecting to win at roulette, I look upon the generally accepted opinion concerning the folly and the grossness of hoping to win at gambling as a thing even more absurd. For why is gambling a whit worse than any other method of acquiring money? How, for instance, is it worse than trade? True, out of 100 persons, only one can win. Yet what business is that of yours or of mine? At all events, I confined myself at first simply to looking on, and decided to attempt nothing serious. Indeed, I felt that if I began to do anything at all, I should do it in an absent-minded, haphazard sort of way. Of that I felt certain. Also, it behooved me to learn the game itself, since, Despite 1,000 descriptions of roulette, which I had read with ceaseless avidity, I knew nothing of its rules, and had never even seen it played. In the first place, everything about it seemed to me so foul, so morally mean and foul. Yet I'm not speaking of the hungry, restless folk who, by scores, nay, even by hundreds, could be seen crowded around the gaming tables. For in a desire to win quickly and to win much, I can see nothing sordid. I've always applauded the opinion of a certain dead-and-gone but cocksure moralist who replied to the excuse that one may always gamble moderately by saying that to do so makes things worse, since, in that case, the profits too will always be moderate. Insignificant profits and sumptuous profits do not stand on the same footing. No, it is all a matter of proportion. What may seem a small sum to a Rothschild may seem a large sum to me. And it is not the fault of stakes or of winnings that everywhere men can be found winning, can be found depriving their fellows of something, just as they do at roulette. As to the question whether stakes and winnings are in themselves immoral is another question altogether, and I wish to express no opinion upon it. Yet the very fact that I was full of a strong desire to win caused this gambling for gain, in spite of its attendant squalor, to contain, if you will, something intimate, something sympathetic to my eyes. For it is always pleasant to see men dispensing with ceremony and acting naturally and in an unbuttoned mood. Yet why should I so deceive myself? I could see that the whole thing was a vain and unreasoning pursuit, and what at the first glance seemed to me the ugliest feature in this mob of roulette players was their respect for their occupation, the seriousness, and even the humility with which they stood around the gaming tables. Moreover, I had always drawn sharp distinctions between a game which is de mauvais genre and a game which is permissible to a decent man. In fact, there are two sorts of gaming, namely, the game of the gentleman and the game of the plebs, the game for gain and the game of the herd. Herein, as said, I draw sharp distinctions. Yet how essentially base are the distinctions? For instance, a gentleman may stake, say, 5 or 10 louis d'or, seldom more, unless he is a very rich man, when he may stake, say, 1,000 francs, but he must do this simply for the love of the game itself, simply for sport, simply in order to observe the process of winning or of losing, and above all things, as a man who remains quite uninterested in the possibility of his issuing a winner. If he wins, he will be at liberty, perhaps, to give vent to a laugh, or to pass a remark on the circumstance to a bystander, or to stake again, or to double his stake, but even this he must do solely out of curiosity, and for the pleasure of watching the play of chances and of calculations, and not because of any vulgar desire to win. In a word, he must look upon the gaming table, upon roulette, and upon trente et quarante, as mere relaxations which have been arranged solely for his amusement. Of the existence of the lures and gains upon which the bank is founded and maintained, he must profess to have not an inkling. Best of all, he ought to imagine his fellow gamblers and the rest of the mob which stands trembling over a coin to be equally rich and gentlemanly with himself, and playing solely for recreation and pleasure. This complete ignorance of the realities, this innocent view of mankind, is what, in my opinion, constitutes the truly aristocratic. For instance, I've seen even fond mothers so far indulge their guileless, elegant daughters, misses of 15 or 16, as to give them a few gold coins and teach them how to play. And though the young ladies may have won or have lost, they have invariably laughed and departed as though they were well pleased. In the same way, I saw our general once approach the table in a stolid, important manner. A lackey darted to offer him a chair, but the general did not even notice him. Slowly he took out his money bags and slowly extracted 300 francs in gold, which he staked on the black, and won. Yet he did not take up his winnings. He left them there on the table. Again the black turned up, and again he did not gather in what he had won. And when in the third round the red turned up, he lost at a stroke 1,200 francs. Yet even then he rose with a smile and thus preserved his reputation. Yet I knew that his money bags must be chafing his heart. As well as that, had the stake been twice or thrice as much again, he would still have restrained himself from venting his disappointment. On the other hand, I saw a Frenchman first win and then lose 30,000 francs, cheerfully and without a murmur. Yes, even if a gentleman should lose his whole substance, he must never give way to annoyance. Money must be so subservient to gentility as never to be worth a thought. Of course, the supremely aristocratic thing is to be entirely oblivious of the mire of rabble with its setting. But sometimes a reverse course may be aristocratic, to remark, to scan, and even to gape at the mob, for preference through a lorgnette, even as though one were taking the crowd and its squalor for a sort of raree show, which had been organized specially for a gentleman's diversion. Though one may be squeezed by the crowd, one must look as though one were fully assured of being the observer, of having neither part nor lot with the observed. At the same time, to stare fixedly about one is unbecoming, for that again is ungentlemanly, seeing that no spectacle is worth an open stare. Are no spectacles in the world which merit from a gentleman too pronounced an inspection. However, to me personally, the scene did seem to be worth undisguised contemplation, more especially in view of the fact that I had come there not only to look at, but also to number myself sincerely and wholeheartedly with, the mob. As for my secret moral views, I had no room for them amongst my actual practical opinions. Let that stand as written. I am writing only to relieve my conscience. Yet let me say also this, that from the first I have been consistent in having an intense aversion to any trial of my acts and thoughts by a moral standard. Another standard altogether has directed my life. As a matter of fact, the mob was playing in exceedingly foul fashion. Indeed, I have an idea that sheer robbery was going on around that gaming table. The croupiers who sat at the two ends of it had not only to watch the stakes, but also to calculate the game. An immense amount of work for two men. As for the crowd itself, well, it consisted mostly of Frenchmen. Yet I was not then taking notes merely in order to be able to give you a description of roulette, but in order to get my bearings as to my behaviour when I myself should begin to play. For example, I noticed that nothing was more common than for another's hand to stretch out and grab one's winnings whenever one had won. Then there would arise a dispute, and frequently an uproar, and it would be a case of, I beg of you to prove and to produce witnesses to the fact that the stake is yours. At first, the proceedings were pure Greek to me. I could only divine and distinguish that stakes were hazarded on numbers, on odd or even, and on colours. Paulina's money I decided to risk that evening only to the amount of 100 gulden. The thought that I was not going to play for myself quite unnerved me. It was an unpleasant sensation, and I tried hard to banish it. I had a feeling that, once I had begun to play for Paulina, I should wreck my own fortunes. Also, I wonder if anyone has ever approached a gaming table without falling an immediate prey to superstition. I began by pulling out 50 gulden and staking them on even. The wheel spun and stopped at 13. I had lost, with a feeling like a sick qualm, as though I would like to make my way out of the crowd and go home. I staked another 50 gulden, this time on the red. The red turned up. Again, I staked the whole sum, and again the red turned up. Clutching my 400 gulden, I placed 200 of them on 12 figures to see what would come of it. The result was that the croupier paid me out three times my total stake. Thus, from 100 gulden, my store had grown to 800. Upon that, such a curious, such an inexplicable, unwonted feeling overcame me that I decided to depart. Always the thought kept recurring to me that if I had been playing for myself alone, I should never have had such luck. Once more I staked the whole 800 gulden on the even. The wheel stopped at 4. I was paid out another 800 gulden, and snatching up my pile of 1600, departed in search of Paulina Alexandrovna. I found the whole party walking in the park, and was able to get an interview with her only after supper. This time the Frenchman was absent from the meal, and the general seemed to be in a more expansive vein. Among other things, he thought it necessary to remind me that he would be sorry to see me playing at the gaming tables. In his opinion, such conduct would greatly compromise him, especially if I were to lose much.
And even if you were to win much, I should be compromised," he added in a meaning sort of way. "Of course I have no right to order your actions, but you yourself will agree that..."
As usual, he did not finish his sentence. I answered dryly that I had very little money in my possession, and that consequently I was hardly in a position to indulge in any conspicuous play, even if I did gamble. At last, when ascending to my own room, I succeeded in handing Polina her winnings, and told her that next time I should not play for her.
"Why not?"
she asked excitedly.
"Because I wish to play for myself,"
I replied with a feigned glance at astonishment.
"That is my sole reason."
"Then are you so certain that your roulette playing will get us out of our difficulties?"
she inquired with a quizzical smile. I said very seriously, "Yes," and then added, "Possibly my certainty about winning may seem to you ridiculous. Yet, pray leave me in peace." Nonetheless, she insisted that I ought to go halves with her in the day's winnings, and offered me 800 gulden, on condition that henceforth I gambled only on those terms. But I refused to do so, once and for all, stating as my reason that I found myself unable to play on behalf of anyone else. "I am not unwilling so to do," I added, "but in all probability I should lose."
"Well, absurd though it be, I place great hopes on your playing of roulette," she remarked musingly. "Wherefore, you ought to play as my partner, and on equal shares."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.